We can talk about technological supremacy and AI and all this, but China's never going to be a rich country unless it becomes a big consumer country. And that's what we have seen the likes of South Korea, Japan be able to make that transition, right? Before we talk about consumption, we have to talk about jobs, right? The jobs are in the services, but service sector only employs about 47% of the Chinese employment and only 50% of GDP. You gotta open those up. The new generation, I totally agree with the fact, they're all about consuming, they're all about leisure, about work-life balance, and they have created all these new entrepreneurial, innovative ways to consume and to develop the local economy rather than line up in the manufacturing factories, to develop that local sphere. So we gotta give them the opportunity.
DeepSeek has certainly shifted the narrative. China is very good at scaling up these innovations and in terms of diffusing them in a way that you can get very good productivity growth, which really has to be the answer for China with declining demographics and so on. In the US, what is interesting is that in the last few quarters, we've actually seen productivity doing quite well. We don't quite know if it is an AI effect, but it seems like that is a plausible interpretation. And if China wants to rely on productivity growth, that is certainly a potential answer. Yeah. Now, the question is whether the rest of the economy, especially the financial system, is going to be set up in a way that you can channel resources to take advantage of that.
DeepSeek has created a lot of confidence in the capital markets and in some segments of the tech sector. DeepSeek has not created confidence in the young people and for employment. In fact, DeepSeek has created some anxiety around, hey, if I have DeepSeek, if I can be much more efficient, do I need these young people anymore? In fact, I think that's one of the things where I think we got to make sure that somehow companies, right, are coming together to kind of figure out, like, if I have a lot of confidence for the future, I can do capital expenditure, I'm going to expand my business, so therefore I'm going to have more employment. Right now I'm very afraid of, well, let's go into Gen AI. There's massive capital going in there, vicious competition, yeah. No progress being made. And so therefore that comes back into, salary levels are low, no employment, right? And that becomes a little bit this vicious cycle. I think we gotta get beyond this, where we have respect, return on assets, return on capital.
There is an absolute illusion of de-risking and decoupling, even among the two big major superpowers, US and China. I hear that all the time, but that's not what the data suggests. In terms of the direct trade and investment, yes, it has gone down between the two countries, but guess what? They are more embedded with each other indirectly than ever before. The countries that the US has been importing more, the four largest countries that have seen the greatest growth, actually happen to be the four economies that China is exporting more to. We're seeing that it's just a realignment of trade, a reorganization of trade. Yes, you're talking about economic fragmentation, geopolitical risk, and that is truthfully an order of magnitude higher than it was before in the 1970s. But the reality is that economic interlinkages are still there.
There is a lot of media attention on where are the breakthroughs, which are the next unicorns, when will we get AGI, to materialize? All these are important conversations, no doubt, but we would like to harness AI in a different way, which is to make sure that the benefits are broad-based, get every Singaporean, every company to really make full use of technology to improve and uplift themselves.
As a leader, it's very easy to tell your workforce, just learn AI skills, and they will not find it helpful. They will not actually feel like they're being supported. So you have to go two levels down, and you have to first be humble about it's we're all in it together. I also might not have AI skills, and I'm learning with you. And that level of humility and leadership actually helps bring the workforce alongside with you.
short courses, boot camps, even different organizations, so that young entrepreneurs and your professionals in general, they can experiment these new technologies. So we need, what I think it's gonna sound a bit childish, but I think that we also need playgrounds so that we can test this new set of skills that are gonna be needed for these new jobs.
When we embarked on our computerization drive in the 1980s, we had very few computers. My family, we weren't rich enough to have a computer, but the government made computers easily accessible to every Singaporean in community centers so we could learn, get used to it. In school, we had a computer club. It was very popular. Many of us would go there to play computer games, no doubt. But along the way, we learned and we got familiar. And it's not just at the top end. Everyone became familiar with computers very quickly. In the same way with AI, let's not get too obsessed with what's happening at the cutting edge. How can I get every worker to master AI tools and be familiar with AI tools to be more productive? That's what we are obsessed about.
Where we find that AI is particularly helpful is there's a large amount of data and there's a specific need, a huge need that otherwise cannot be solved and served. And one of these is what we call the industrial co-pilot, that similar like in healthcare, it's a co-worker that actually works with you in setting up machines, programming machines, and really saving significant cost. 200 customers already worldwide that are using it, really ramps up now in China, because what we see is we have a population, an aging population, that actually gets out of the workforce. With that, a lot of knowledge gets lost, and the only way how to capture that is the AI. So what if we can capture all that knowledge, we put it into the AI, and then it actually helps you, and it lowers the barrier for you in terms of being a trained technician. And these are the things that we're looking for AI, that can solve a necessity, a real, real need.
In the West, you know, at the moment we see a high degree of political polarization, and in some ways, and I think this is possibly an uncomfortable truth, this is a result of the way in which we've talked about the imperative of the energy transition. We have tended to center the imperative of climate change and that we need to do the energy transition because of climate change. And of course, this is absolutely true. This is the moral imperative, but the problem is that is only one of the reasons why it's imperative to do the energy transition. And an almost exclusive focus on the climate change imperative has led us to emphasize, I think, the costs of the transition. And so I think what we need to do, especially in the West, is to recast how we think about the purpose of the energy transition. It's not just about addressing climate change. It's about promoting this really comprehensive security-enhancing agenda. It's about energy security. It's about economic security. It's about social security. And it's about geostrategic security as well.
This is important not just for the energy sources, but for employment, productivity, for GDP. And also trying to weather the headwinds when it comes to the sluggish growth that we're seeing in the global economy. So when I look at the renewable sector, I'm not just looking at it from the angle of lower CO2 emissions, energy transition. I'm looking at it in terms of FDI opportunity, in terms of employment opportunity, in terms of drawing in low-cost capital, which has become fundamental.
China approaches the energy transition in a way that is very different from many other countries, particularly in the West. It understands that the energy transition is a massive national security multiplier. And so by turbocharging the energy transition, we see governments in China and indeed in Japan and Korea understanding that they can boost energy security by reducing fossil fuel reliance. They can boost economic security by building the new export-oriented industries of the future. They can boost environmental security by reducing emissions and reducing particulate pollution. They can boost social security by creating new jobs and promoting regional development, and they can boost geostrategic security by promoting a good green image to the world, attracting allies and new energy partners. So this is a very sophisticated green energy statecraft that we see emerging in East Asia.
Investment is genuinely shifting. This, as an economic historian, is perhaps one of the most staggering graphs that you can see out there. This is the balance between renewable and fossil investment. And if you told me 20 years ago that, according to this year's numbers, renewable investment in energy would be twice what it is in fossil, I would have asked to be smoking some of what you were smoking. That is our reality today. And it isn't because fossil has collapsed, it's because there has been a gigantic surge in renewable, above all led by China.
I don't think just more macroeconomic analysis will cut through. What we find cutting through most powerfully is being able to tell stories that bring to life what does this mean in practical terms. So some of the communications from the insurance sector are really powerful. The board member of Allianz telling a story of the, not just the likelihood, but the certainty of a climate-induced credit crunch, that can be really powerful. Or telling the very real stories of direct losses, Panama Canal having reduced revenues because of low water levels and so on. You can't manufacture if you can't get access to water.
Thank you.